In the 1898 novel Edison's Conquest of Mars, astronauts travel to the moon and find, among other things, some mountains made out of diamond-like moon jewels. According to the narrator, these mountains could provide, quote, an inexhaustible mine of wealth. And over the past two centuries, the idea of a lunar mine, as well as mines on asteroids and comets, has gained a lot of traction. Not to extract moon jewels, of course, but water, oxygen, helium-3, and a ton of different metals. There's a whole heap of challenges, but a lot of interested parties are working on ways to access those precious, precious resources. For example, to collect certain metals, we may wind up launching a crew of microscopic miners. Our moon contains a ton of different types of metals, everything from boring old aluminum and iron to the rare earth elements that are critical components in a lot of modern technology. People might want to ship some of those metals back to Earth, and some they might want to keep up in space so they don't have to waste a bunch of money and rocket fuel launching materials from Earth. But wherever these metals end up, scientists are trying to work out exactly how to mine them. That includes one particularly nifty technique called biomining. While we often think of mining as a huge operation involving pickaxes, explosives, and power tools, mining at its core is just any method by which we extract metals from the ground. And as the name implies, biomining relies on biological organisms, like microbes and fungi. It might seem far-fetched, but biomining is actually being used on Earth right now. Not in random R&D labs, but actual industry. It's estimated that about a fifth of copper production comes from biomining, and biomining has also been used to extract other metals, like uranium, nickel, and gold. But why would microbes even want to mine metals? Well, as much as microbes want to do anything anyway. It turns out they care less about the metal and more about the electrons in all those metallic atoms. Certain types of microbes and fungi gain energy from a chemical reaction called oxidation, which causes a chemical compound to lose electrons. Those lost electrons don't just disappear, they simply go somewhere else. And that going means the microbe or fungus has a form of energy transport and leaves behind a chemically altered version of the metal that humans can use. When a metal becomes oxidized, it can take on some radically different properties. The classic example is iron becoming rust, but for biomining, we mostly care that some oxidized metals will become more soluble. In other words, they'll dissolve way easier. What are they dissolving into? Probably an acid. The species that we use for biomining tend to thrive in acidic environments, so that's the setup they get to live in. Now, there are a few different kinds of biomining, but all of them involve getting ores in acid at some point. For example, a technique called heap leaching involves crushing up your chunks of ore, stacking layers of all that crushed ore onto an impermeable sheet, and then pouring acid over the whole thing. But what all of these setups have in common is that after the metals get oxidized by the microbes, either directly or indirectly, they slip out of the rocks and minerals and into the acid. That acid then gets collected and put into a bioreactor so the metals can get extracted. There are a lot of different extraction techniques, and they all involve chemical reactions that turn the metals insoluble again. And being insoluble means they'll settle out of the solution, turning into little grains or flakes of a metallic compound. From there, a process called electrowinning is used to make the flakes settle onto a plate, forming a coating that can then be collected and used for whatever you want. Compared to more traditional mining methods, biomining has a few perks. For example, the microbes we use can do their little miner jobs at a cool 50 degrees Celsius, which, yes, is not a temperature you or I would ever want to work in, but compare that to the furnaces we use to smelt metals, which can regularly reach temperatures of 1,000 degrees Celsius. Since biomining can be operated at lower temperatures and without using so many toxic solvents, it reduces the pollution associated with traditional mining. It's also a lot less energy intensive, meaning that it's not as expensive as traditional mining, and can be used to process low-grade ores, which would be a waste of money to tackle using normal tools. And it requires much less equipment than traditional mining, at least on Earth. But this episode isn't about biomining on Earth. It's about biomining on the moon, and moon-adjacent objects in space. How feasible is this plan? Before we can answer that question, here's a quick ad.
Thanks to Jump for supporting this SciShow video. Jump is a statistical analysis software designed to help you out, whether you're just getting started or have made it to expert mode. Jump helps you with problems like trying to figure out which of your way too many variables are the most meaningful and hold the most leverage. You just use their predictor screening functionality and you'll have an answer in no time. It's the kind of analysis that makes you feel like a real pro. So at that point, you might as well go for Jump's pro features like spectral analysis. From screening to transformations, Jump has you covered through your whole data analysis process. You can check them out with a 30-day free trial for anyone, anywhere at jmp.com/scishow.
Setting aside the obvious ethical concerns with taking our species' tendency towards overconsumption off-world, let's talk about the politics. Our outer space treaties aren't particularly robust at the moment, which leaves room for exploitation. And there are enough examples from history that if there's a loophole anywhere in legislation, someone will walk through it. But even if everyone got along and promised not to strip mine the solar system for profit, would biomining even work? Well, in contrast to all those perks I mentioned, biomining does have its downsides. It takes far longer than traditional mining techniques and requires very specific temperature conditions to function, which would be hard to maintain in space. For example, over the course of the 4-week-long lunar day, the surface at the moon's equator can swing between about negative 130 degrees all the way up to 120 degrees Celsius. Biomining reactions are also usually aerobic, meaning that they require oxygen gas, and the moon is not exactly known for having a lot of that. On Earth, biomining is considered a complement to traditional mining, not a replacement. So it's going to take time to scale up this technology so it can be used on its own in an entirely different environment. That said, initial tests have been promising. Two successful biomining experiments have been conducted on the International Space Station, and one of them was done using actual chunks of asteroid instead of rocks from Earth that were a close enough match. Another study showed that you can take rocks similar to those on Mars and the Moon and then extract iron that can be 3D printed into structural materials. In other words, astronauts might be able to build out their Mars base with Martian iron. And even more research has found that at least one biomining fungus species isn't hindered by the moon's low gravity. So that's promising too, but there are still a few kinks to work out. Lunar dust is super fine, super clingy, and super abrasive, which can be murder on machines. And while biomining on Earth requires less equipment than traditional methods, biomining on the moon is going to need more, since those microbes won't survive when exposed to an airless world that swings hundreds of degrees over the course of a day. Proponents of biomining say that these are just technical challenges that will eventually be overcome with new technology, but it remains to be seen whether biomining would be an effective use of anyone's time. Still, the science seems to show that biomining could be possible, and with as much power and money behind it as it seems to have, we could be getting some of our rare metals from space sooner than we think.